So hi, welcome to another week of data engineering. Let's start with a quick summary of what we saw last week. So last week was about relational databases, and a relational database is managed by a piece of software, and that provides access to one or more databases. Each database has users, users that have access, read and write access, sometimes also administrators that can change the schema, create and drop tables, things like that. And each database consists of tables. A table has columns. Each column is of a certain type. There are constraints on the columns, such as a not null constraint. A table has a primary key, which is either a single column or a set of columns that together uniquely identify a row. And a table can have zero or more foreign keys. So these are links to another table, and they usually reference the primary key of another table. Then we talked about transactions. So transactions are very important in a large numbers of applications. So the prototypical example of a transaction is a bank transfer, where you want to make sure that all the update statements are executed atomically. So that means as a whole. So if you transfer money from one account to another, you want it to be impossible that, for example, you lose 100 euros. And that it's not transferred to the other account because halfway the database server crashed or something. So you want all transactions to be atomic, also isolated. So that means several people can run transactions in parallel, and you want these transactions to be independent of each other, even if they are executed at exactly the same time. Consistent means that the database after the transaction should be in a consistent state. So, for example, if you have a foreign key to an address table and another user wants to delete that address, then the transaction will either fail or prevent the other parallel transaction from doing something like that. So, to keep the database in a consistent state. And also durable. So durable means that after a transaction has committed, the results of your transaction are saved to disk, in essence. The mechanism that controls this is a transaction manager. It ensures that all the concurrently running transactions are executed properly, and it uses an algorithm called two-phase locking. So with two-phase locking, you have two phases. In the first phase, you acquire a number of locks. These can be read or write locks. And then at the end of your transaction, you release all locks. So with a lock, for instance, on a row, this means you're the only user that can either read that row or read and write to that row. And then if another concurrent transactions wants to access that row with a lock on, he has to wait. So there are two cases there. If it's two transactions reading the same data, that can be safely done in parallel. But if one transaction is writing to the row, then the other transaction has to wait. So that's in essence what two-phase locking is. And then we also saw the query optimizer. So the goal of the query optimizer is to consider different options for executing the query, to consider that and then select the plan that's the most efficient, is estimated to be the most efficient. Then we saw SQL, structured query language. So SQL is a declarative programming language, which means that you do not specify how the query computes, sorts the data, or performs a join using data structures and so on, as you do in regular programming languages such as Python. So SQL is declarative, so you say what you want, but not how to compute it. And there are three commands for updating a data. So insert inserts a new row, delete deletes one or more rows, and update updates one or more rows. And then we saw the select query to retrieve data. So you select a couple of columns from one or more tables where, and then you have the condition in the where clause. You can also select data from multiple tables using joins. And so for instance, if you want to join table A and B and they're connected using a foreign and a primary key, you can write that as shown on the slides. And finally, the third type of query we saw was group by queries. So there you group on some type of column, like the type of products, and then you can count or compute the maximum or the sum or whatever statistic on within that group. So that's also a very important type of query. So what are possible exam questions? Well, one obvious exam question is that you have to write an SQL query. So for instance, return the total number of shipments of suppliers from London. So normally you would have practiced SQL last week with Janu. In case you didn't do that, you can still obviously do it now. And I also provided this link, so that's sqlzoo.net. It has a lot of simple queries, and it's an interactive platform where you can practice your SQL queries if you are still not if you still need some practicing. Okay, this concludes the summary of last week. Any questions before I continue with the main topic of this week? No questions? Are we going to learn other languages such as Spark and Cypher or only SQL? Okay, that's a very interesting question. So Cypher we are not going to cover. This week we are going to do exercises on MongoDB. And so Cypher is a query language used in graph databases, but we're not going to use that. Spark will be covered after the Easter holiday, when we are going to talk about MapReduce and distributed programming. So that's something we're going to practice. Any more questions? Okay, you're welcome, Carlos. Okay, then I'm going to start with the main topic of this week. And I have two presentations. The first presentation is on data warehousing. And then a presentation on NoSQL.